So, hi Fred, thanks so much for joining us here today. So, I think we're going to jump straight in. I think really at the precipice of something exciting here with Cardano, and the breadth of talks happening at the summit is a real indication of that. And I think the first thing we really need to talk about are the NFTs. And can you tell me what's happening in the in this space with the Cardano Foundation?
Sure, I would be super happy to do so. So it's been really exciting to see the amount of NFTs who's basically been minted on our blockchain, and also the use of metadata around that. And we see also a lot of things emerging around using NFTs as access control to smart contracts and to dApps and so forth. So I think it's really something we want to support. And for us, what's really important is open source tools. So what we're going to do is we are creating a secure enterprise-grade open source tool for enterprises, which will further reduce the barriers for entry for enterprises to build solutions on Cardano. So what does that really mean? Well, it means that we've seen a lot of individuals minting NFTs and a lot of projects coming, which is great from different artists and so forth. But we would like to ensure that some kind of a standard emerges. And what we've seen is a lot of people has been following the SIP 25 standard for NFTs, which was made and adopted by the community. So what we're going to do is we're going to create, and we already started, an API first web service where different NFT creators can issue their NFTs. So basically, it's an NFT API tool who provides some core functionality, supports the SIP 25 for different businesses, and it makes it a lot easier for marketplaces or websites to basically build on top of that. And it also creates much more interoperability. So thinking about it is an open tool library, which basically will promote a certain standard. And that standard will also make it a lot easier for all the explorers out there and everybody who's grinding the data to kind of find these NFTs and to ensure that there's interoperability between that. And you can actually also export that out to some of the larger platforms out there.
And can you tell me kind of what are the key differences between this standard and other standards, maybe?
Well, there is not that many standards on Cardano at the moment. And we see that is emerging as more and more enterprise adoption and more normal adoption is happening. And what we would like to support is that these some of these standards come into play. What we've seen on other blockchains is that when a standard emerges, it gets a lot easier for businesses and developers to basically to build on top of that. And it also makes it easier to evaluate and audit it, and makes it easier to switch the tokens between different platforms. So it's really a push towards getting some kind of standards, which is already defined by the community. And we're just supporting that with some tools in the back end for that. So it will bring more adoption, and it will bring hopefully more enterprises, and it will bring a bigger eye from some of the large platforms out there, marketplaces who's been building on other blockchains, to basically encourage them to integrate or come to Cardano as well.
Does this really fit in with our kind of mission and our goals that you set out during the summer around kind of really building an institutional, a platform that's attractive for institutional kind of adoptees? And kind of what would you say about that?
Yeah, that's exactly it, right? So what we really need is to ensure that the way you interact with the platform becomes as easy and as transparent and as solid as possible. And then we have these three words I keep talking about with the is the resilience, the reliability of the platform, right? And how that really plays together. Because what large enterprises or larger businesses, because we see these large businesses coming, what they want is to ensure that how they interact with the platform is enterprise grade, and that is the uptime is there, and they can trust the data from the integration layers and the APIs in the middle layers. So it's also about building from our side a kind of a reference API, which the community then also can then at a later stage either take the source code from or even take over.
And I think this kind of brings us nicely on to kind of a part on kind of the delegation. And so it goes back in April, I think the foundation moved from a three epoch delegation cycle to a quarterly delegation cycle. And I think at the start of October, we're going to start delegating again, so which is really exciting. Can you tell me a bit what we're going to focus on?
Yeah, that's correct. So we wanted to move to a 3 months or a quarterly delegation because it gave us some more speed in terms of our execution. It sounds a bit funny that we say we get more speed, but it allows us to ensure that the processes was in place on on the token level. The other part was we felt that we were delegating towards mainly decentralization to small stake pools. And we are now looking into supporting some of these great news we just announced here at the summit around circular economy and sustainability. So we're really looking into changing that, a part of our delegation methodology, to also support some of these impact pools and some of these initiatives which we just announced. So I think that's super exciting as well. And we will try and do everything we can from the foundation side to keep, you know, supporting stake pools who is thinking a little bit different and who is, you know, fighting the fight every day to ensure that the security of the network, but also to try and change the world. And I think those initiatives goes very well hand in hand.
Yeah. And can you kind of maybe tell us a little bit about kind of how you're supporting kind of these different stake pools specifically?
Sure. Well, one thing is, of course, the delegation, right, that we delegate on a quarterly basis. Another thing is that we are looking at building an advisory board around that. And the third part, which is probably the larger announcement, is that we are doing a three-year grant with the University of Zurich, with the Blockchain Observatory, where the mandate basically is that they're going to implement the Cardano blockchain into their tool sets. And what that basically is going to do is that it's going to create a situation where we can get a review of the consensus protocol and the incentives to support a continued decentralization and an active governance of Cardano. So really what it does is it's giving us you know, some postdocs for a three-year period to do research, really data-driven research on the blockchain on a transaction level, also looking at the staking dynamics and the Cardano protocol parameters, including the stake pool operator parameters, to ensure that that we as the foundation has sufficient knowledge and insights to support you know, the healthy growth of stake pools. And we had a lot of discussion with different stake pools, and there's you know, a lot of opinions about, you know, small stake pools versus big stake pools, and you know, how Ouroboros and later Ouroboros Omega actually is going to do that. But our aim is really to ensure this further decentralization. But we need the data, and we need it, you know, from a non-biased source, which is also monitoring other blockchains to really see how these incentives and how these things actually play along over time. So it's really about you know, giving the University of Zurich the time and the ability to also look at the Cardano blockchain and compare that to other world leading blockchains, and to give us early data points, which will allow us to work with the community and the stake pool operators to optimize a fair system on the blockchain.
Yeah, and I think that the partnership with the University of Zurich is incredibly interesting, because it really lays down the groundwork for what we're talking about, what we're about, is just education and kind of research. And I think I want to know a little bit more about why maybe specifically you partnered with the University of Zurich.
Yeah, I think in reality we had been having a working relationship with the University of Zurich for a long time. We also have with a couple of other universities. And we felt that the value proposition with the Blockchain Observatory, where they're already looking at the Bitcoin chain and Ethereum and Bitcoin Cash and other change, it basically felt like they had the knowledge and they had the tool sets which will allow us to actually do that at this time. The other part is that the foundation is based in Switzerland, which allows us to be quite close. And this is the first long-term collaboration and grant we give to a university out of the Cardano Foundation. So it also allows us to be a bit more closer on the ball and on the working packages. And I think specifically the working packages are really important for us, that we get that right. Because it's not like core academic research on how to do a better blockchain. It's really about monitoring the protocol parameters and the incentives and what's actually happening on the blockchain, and comparing that with other blockchains to ensure this healthy ecosystem keeps thriving. And what we also want to look at is, for instance, the rights and the participation which is happening. So it's not just about, you know, the transaction, but also what kind of participation, and later when voting comes online on the mainnet, right? We want to also, you know, get our heads and grasp around that we can really get the right kind of dynamics in place, and we are forewarned. So if you look at what we're doing right now with the API backend and building that API backend, I think if we would have had sufficient data in an earlier stage, we could have kicked that off maybe, you know, 2-3 months earlier, and we would have been able to support a lot more of the NFT creation on the chain by actually, you know, kicking that API backend off earlier. So I think it's really about also front running some of those initiatives we see in the data on the blockchain.
Yeah, and I think that's a really, really interesting. It's the fact that we're going to be seeing trends, not spotlight, not really placing a spotlight on kind of a 1 year partnership that's actually just going to be over 3 years. And can you tell me a little bit more about the economic functioning? Because I think that's something that might interest our community a bit.
The economic function in terms of the grant or in terms of the how they're going to measure it?
Yeah, and the work package, I think, would be really interesting to talk about from the University of Zurich.
Yeah, so we will do a blog post around that at a later stage. We're just right now evaluating the last bits and pieces of the work package, and we're waiting here for the summit to kind of announce this. But in essence, we're kind of in agreement with the University of Zurich, right? And the work package is overarchingly defined, but I think it would be better to share that in a blog post at a later time.
We'll make sure to everyone to watch this space because there's some really exciting things coming up. So make sure to check out our blog post for sure. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And the other part about University of Zurich is that they have something called the Blockchain Summer School, right? And the Blockchain Summer School is something we participated in for 2 years in a row now, which is basically an open summer school. You have to pay for it, unfortunately, where people can come and learn about not just different blockchains and different protocols, but they also get very deep into the gist of it. And this year we actually went that far that the students had the ability to basically to code an oracle on the Cardano blockchain using Wolfram, Wolfram Alpha, and using different aspects of the Cardano blockchain and some of the components of Malawi. And I think that was just, you know, truly magical that students within, you know, a short amount of time actually have that ability to do an oracle there. So it's also about education and ensuring that more universities put the spotlight on blockchain and what these decentralized applications can do, but also the delta towards the centralized, let's say, DLT space. And where is it that you can actually find added value in the decentralization compared to the centralization?
I think, as I said earlier, it's like the groundwork for strong educations and foundation. Yeah, and I suppose I think we're kind of coming up on time soon. So I kind of suppose I want to talk about kind of our recent announcements on our board and kind of look at the recent updates we've had. And I think we have some excellent kind of skill sets and a really great constellation of skills and talents and understanding on the board. Is there anything kind of you'd like to kind of give an update to us on that?
I mean, as we have announced, the previous board or council has stepped down. We called it a council before, now the name is a board. And we thank them very much for all the hard work and all the things they've really put into motion. As you know, as we communicated before, we have a 2-year running cycle on the board. So it's a bit of a natural transition we're doing now. But I think what we've been really focusing on with the new people joining is that America is a very important market for us, and we see a lot of things happening in the Americas right now in terms of regulation. So it was very important for us to get a regulatory expert on the board, which can guide the foundation in terms of how do we support stake pool operators, how do we support creators of code, how do we support tokens and so forth in the Americas. So having Mary Beth Buchanan, which is used to be the general counsel for Kraken and Bitstamp and has been a United States attorney for the Department of Justice for many, many years on the board, I think this is extremely valuable and will give us the right guidance. On the Swiss side, we also focus on ensuring that we had a capital markets lawyer. As many of you know, being in blockchain can sometimes be a bit tricky. Because on one hand, we are redefining finance and how finance is going to look in the future. But we are also in certain ways, for certain banks and capital markets players, we are threatening them a little bit. And there is all these new rules about AML and KYC and where does that fit in and so on. So I'm really having Gillian McNabb and her deep fintech and capital markets knowledge and the foundation knowledge she has about foundation law is going to help us. So that basically means now, two legal experts or regulatory legal experts on the board, one basically representing Europe and Switzerland and one representing the US. I think this was, a very good timing for us in terms of the maturity of the protocol, but also the maturity of the foundation, the work we're going to do according to the strategy presentation as we published a couple of months ago. And then the other one is Andreas Eschbach. Andreas Eschbach has more than 20 years experience from a Big Four, and he's been working very much around smart contract review, very much around how do you audit a blockchain, how do you audit a token, how do you actually change audit methodology, how do you prove provenance, how do you bridge that in, so when a Fortune 500 company that they want to use the Cardano blockchain to optimize their business processes, and by that they're buying some ADA to get access to that, and they're launching a whole set of smart contracts, or maybe even moving some of their core ledgers away from SAP Financial or Oracle Financial Solutions, right, and into the Cardano protocol. It's very important for us that not only do we have, very solid code and standards in place, but we also have the ability of proving that to the necessary auditors and the necessary supervisory authorities who are supervising these very large enterprises. The other part, which is experience we want to kind of tap into, is the certification of implementation providers. We're already working now together with IOG and Imurco with several IT companies who's getting very deep into Pluto's and into the core of Haskell. But we would like to get to a place that there is a, some kind of certification program where we can, send, companies to when they want to do large projects. And what would obviously be great is to key that into the existing community. So the existing community members who's been supporting and really building on Cardano for a long time, that they have this ability also to bridge into these certified solution providers or implementation providers over time. So it's a hope that that his knowledge can bring that in. Then we are, at the time of recording, I'm not really allowed to say it, but we're also bringing a fourth person in, and I hope we can basically announce that just around the summit, but we're recording a bit before that. And he has a lot of experience. He's based out of Japan, and he has a lot of experience from the 80s and 90s about the Linux and all the IBM and Googles of the world and how the whole open source movement was running. And the reason we are bringing him on board is basically based on a governance perspective, because we're going into the Voltaire era. And I think where the foundation really is going to take its stand is also around how Voltaire is going to define the future of the Cardano blockchain, but also a lot about what does open source really mean, and how do we actually encourage not just a lot of commits from a tightly knit circle of Haskell developers, but how do we actually spread that out so we get much more commits from a much larger community. And he has a lot of experience in actually doing that. So I think that's a new skill set. And I think it's really matching extremely well with where the protocol and where the foundation for maturity level is today. So we are super grateful for all the hard work the old board has done. And I said that this 2-year period it seems to be a very natural change. But also now with the Alonso hard fork and smart contracts, we are really just, trying to ensure that we have a fully independent board with the right skill sets to guide the foundation and to ensure that we can grow and make even more impact and really start augmenting the enterprise adoption and de-risking the use of the protocol for enterprises, regulators, and capital markets players.
Yeah, so that sounds really, really exciting. We've got an incredible kind of few months ahead of us. So thanks, Fred. It's been really great chatting with you today. And I suppose, do you have any final remarks for our community on the foundation updates? Before we head.
You're welcome, and enjoy the rest of the summit. We're really, really proud about all these things happening, and thank you for supporting the Cardano community and the Cardano protocol. I think we really have a chance now to change the world with smart contracts, and we can move beyond the more token standards and really move into to identity and enterprise optimization and business optimization and all those things which will allow people to really voice their opinion and create an impact out there in the world.
Great. Thanks, Fred.